Jesus Christ, the fivefold, the apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, the teacher. I pray a hedge around all of them tonight as I lay my hands on this man of God. And Lord, I ask you to keep them in Jesus' name. Thank you for putting your hand on this man and providing every need that he has. You're a good God. You're a mighty God. And Lord, we give you thanks and praise and glory. Bless him now, Master, as he brings the word of life to us. We're going to give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. And the church said a great big loud.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Hey, won't you take a moment and talk to them? Just tell them how much they mean to us. Yeah. You, yeah. Well, that's why I want you to do it.
He always does this at the last minute. And we'd like to thank y'all so much for caring for us. It seemed like when there was a big need, the church was always there to help us financially and with your prayers, and we thank you so much for it.
Amen. 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 Wow. I did something whenever, every time you'd help, and I know we've got guests in the house and that, and may not have known that I had lost my sigmoid colon to diverticulitis. It decided to explode in my body, and I could have died, but God helped me. But the financial help is, and I'm fearful. Jonathan and Candy Eakin are here, you know, and they're just doing their best. They're itching to get on the evangelistic field, and they probably don't need to hear me testifying like this, but there's just nothing out there to fall back on. The Assemblies of God are great people, but we don't have a plan, Troy, that says if you got a bad illness, that Springfield is just gonna mail you checks. I thought about several times when I would receive your checks from this church, and let me tell you, it wasn't $400 or $500. It was many times more than that. When my girls would come over, and Pat knows my daughters. Pat knows Janelle and April. They've been raised in a preacher's home all their life. And I thought about some of the people that those checks, Pam, I thought about you. How they probably got in the mail and came to me, and how that you were asked to help and be a blessing. My girls would come to the house, and I made sure that those girls would see those checks, and I run it under their nose to let them know that God was taking care of their mama and daddy.
Amen.
My grandkids knew. BB could tell you. Well, BB, don't let her in your house. She'll know everything about you. She's my buddy. She knows. We couldn't believe it. We were sitting there expecting at any time, when do we go down? But we had the church packed in around us so tightly that there was no place to go down.
Thank God.
What a wonderful report of people that don't get to see you but maybe once a year or at the beginning of deer season. I'll see you in November, Lord tarries. And Mona called the girls in, I don't know, from time to time, Ian. She'd tell our girls, there's no reason we haven't gone bankrupt but God. And so we thank you. Thank you. Keep those cards and letters coming in. My goodness. Amazing to me how you blessed us, and we thank you for that. And of course, so does, Bank of America. They hold the mortgage on my home. I can't take credit for what happened here this morning. That'll lie in your hands, because there's just not a bunch of churches out there that are willing that when you begin to meditate upon the Lord and pursue the Spirit of God, not everybody wants to go after Him. And this morning, you pursued. You stayed with Him. You refused to back out of it, of relationship, and there was a huge kiss, and we got hung up right in the middle of the smack. And it was good, and I appreciate it. I needed it. And I appreciate Pat telling me that today. He said, Myrtle got a brand new husband, and I started looking around. But he was talking about him. what a joy being with you. I enjoyed this morning. That it doesn't have to be the exception. Just that in June of 1995 over in Pensacola, Florida, that I'm gonna mention in my message tonight, those people never dreamed that on Father's Day of 1995 that God was going to show up and show out in a revival that would last for many years. And you've been talking about revivals and the Wesleyans, John and Charles Wesley, what dynamite men. And I pray that we're a people that will never let go of Pentecost. I trust that you stay hungry for the things of God. Amen. I will tell you, I've been back to my doctor, and Dr. Amir Carney, and he looked at me when you'll love this. When I had the surgery, he told Mona, he said, "You start packing that man full of food and protein." And she said, "Well, I don't think that's going to be a problem." He said, I'm fearful that he could digress, and I want to make sure that his system is functioning. You can see I'm getting very well." And so I went back after I had the second surgery, and he said, "Okay, pal, you can lighten up now." I said, "Do what?" He said, "Yeah, I do want you to kind of go ahead and start losing some weight." Because of all the muscles, and I had wires, in fact, they were called cables, that held my stomach muscles together because of all the cutting he had done. When they began to open me up, I had had a screen put in for a hernia back several years ago, and that thing was full of the same infection that was propagated by the diverticulitis. And so they literally had to fillet me and slice it. Instead of going in just one way, they had to fillet the flesh and lay it away from the screen and remove it. And when they did, they had to tie me all back together. And I'm telling you all that to tell you that I will never have my girlish figure again. And I asked for a bikini cut, and well, it just didn't happen. What can I say? So he tells me, "Yeah, I need you to. You may always be round for the rest of your life, but you need to lighten up." I said, "What do you want me to do?" He said, "Lose weight." I said, "How?" He said, "By exercise and dieting." I said, "I don't think it'll work." He said, "Why not?" I said, "Well, I go to exercising, I sweat. My sweat smells like bacon, and I get hungry." And that's so that's just, amen, amen, amen. I love you, Jonathan. I appreciate you, pal. I love what you're doing. Get ready for an exciting ride. Isn't that right, Pat? Like they used to tell me when I was bull riding, take a deep seat, get a faraway look in your eye. That's right. Acts, the second chapter. Let's go there quickly. Amen. Mona, thank you for your comments to the church. I just knew it would be so meaningful. I didn't get to mention BB. BB is single. Her real name is Haley. And we're trying to marry her off as quick as we can. Because she's eating me and her nanny out of house and home. And yes. She's been a delight, I'm telling you. But if you're locked up into a hotel room with her, whoo, are we glad we're going home tonight? Huh? Oh, that figures. Well, the grass needs to be mowed anyway. Acts, the second chapter. How many of you know what grandkids are? They're God's gift to us for not killing our kids when they were teenagers. That's right. Amen. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each of them. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. There were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now, when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together, were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. They were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, "Behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, dwellers in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God." They were all amazed and were in doubt, saying to one another, "What meaneth this?" Others mocking said, "These men are full of new wine." But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, "Ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words, for these are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it's but 9 o'clock in the morning, third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall come to pass in last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my Spirit. They shall prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above, signs in the earth beneath, blood, fire, vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood, before the great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved." I want to preach to you for a time tonight, simplistic message called the message of Pentecost. Father, I just magnify you. Thank you for the great day that we have already had. And I pray, Lord, as we break the bread of life tonight, that, Lord, you would touch me. Lord, help me to speak as it would be mighty oracles of God, and anoint my tongue, make it as the pen of the ready writer, as David would declare. And I pray that you'll change hearts, change us forever for your greatness, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our forefathers in April of 1906, from the Azusa Street Revival to the Pensacola Revival that I mentioned, that began in June 1995, proved true what we really had already learned from the Scripture, that any great work of God that the church has ever witnessed has always been preceded in a season of prayer. How many of you understand that? That's a wonderful statement for us to grasp and get a hold to, because the upper room experience was no doubt one of the largest prayer meetings
of their time, and it resulted in this powerful display of our supernatural God. God would choose it not only to be the experience of Pentecost to introduce great gifts of the Spirit, but it was the birth of the early church. I know that you've got friends that probably would like to have titled the name of their church the First Church. But you need to know that the First Church was a Pentecostal church. Love the way you're shouting now. One commentator looking back at the day of Pentecost wrote, where the ministry of the Spirit is absent, the church is but a breathless body. What a positive, a true statement. For Jesus said in John 6 and 63, it is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So I want to take a few moments to examine the day of Pentecost. First, I want you to look where they were. Verse 1 says that they were all in one accord and one place. I will tell you this, the reversal must be true, that actually they were in one place because they were all in one accord. Amen. Forgive me for how I know this, but you could take two full-grown tomcats and put them in a feed sack, tie the top together, and throw it over the clothesline, and you may have togetherness, but you do not have unity. My parents would leave on the weekend. Dad bought a place up on Lake Livingston, and there he and Mom would take our youngest brother, Brian, for he was a child that they dearly deserved. Bob, good to see you back there. I see the way you're grinning at that remark. My dad would set us on the couch and look at me and Russell and declare, guys, I'm doing my best to pastor this community, and you're painting the town red. They would go off on weekends, and they would go catch a fish or two and leave on Friday, come back Saturday evening and be refreshed for Sunday morning worship. And, boy, they'd leave me and Russell there together, and it was not a good scene many times when they got home, because we could tear up an anvil. Russell could cook. He made some of the best mayonnaise sandwiches I ever tasted in my life. And he could do great French fries when he wasn't burning the kitchen down. I remember telling him, get in there, fix me something to eat. And can you imagine that boy at 14 years of age wouldn't listen to what this 16-year-old told him to do? And then the fight would be on. At least the attempt, he would take off running out the back door. And when he would, I'd chase him around that little frame house of ours there in Channelview, Texas. And Russell had this wonderful ability of running in the back door. Y'all remember chain latches? Russell could chain latch that door all in one move when he came in the back door. It's obvious to you by now that we had done that many times. And I remember the moment whenever I thought, man, he just knew that it was all over with. And it was until he put his nose up against that glass pane in that door. We replaced that. I'm simply telling you that you could put us two boys together. And I look back at it now. I watch my grandchildren from time to time get into a tiff or to a fight. And I'll just be honest, it just sickens me to watch them fight. And I think so much how my dad used to just grieve over us boys fighting one another. And I'm just saying to you, it was possible for Russell and I to be together, but you certainly did not have unity. And I'm telling you, there are churches today that are praying for revival. They are praying for the supernatural to break loose all across their auditorium. I'll be frank with you, and one of my pastors, only pastored two churches one for 13 years and one for 12 years. And in one of those churches, when they voted me in, they voted me in almost 100%. But can I tell you, they love me, but this side didn't love this side. I remember my district superintendent calling me to the office on Holland Avenue. Brother Burroughs asked me, he said, now that the church has got a pastor, I want to give you all these letters. Letters? What letters? The letters they've written on one another. It's really hard to have the victory. It's hard to have church. It's hard, difficult, if not impossible, to try to have revival with that group. I am telling you, that's why there had to be a preceding time of prayer in the upper room. And boy, whenever God got those people in one accord with one another, and they didn't care whether they got their way or not, the color of the carpet, the color of the paint on the wall didn't have to match up to what they desired. I want you to know, revival broke out. Something supernatural broke into the room when they got in one accord. There are churches that would love for me to come. A dear friend of ours, he won't mind a bit, Brother Rod Young down in Corpus Christi, and a former missionary to the high schools with Youth Alive. And he called me sometime a year or two ago. We go there and preach for Rod usually every July or August. And I remember him calling me early one year and saying, I need to know if you can help me. I said, what do you need, Brother Rod? He said, I looked around here on Wednesday night at our church, and I'm telling you, Brother Gene, we are D-E-D dead. Thank you. I went to school in Channelview. We went there and had a powerful revival. And how many of you know it took about 3 days of healing among one another, people asking forgiveness for hard feelings. And when the church comes in unity, things begin to take place. To be filled with the Spirit, we must be empty of our selfishness and pride. And to experience one accord, you must be willing to pray Jesus' prayer, not my will, but thy will be done. Because in the end result of this thing, you know what I'm preaching tonight, that this is not simply about you and him. It's about him and them. Amen. Right. Have you ever noticed the phraseology of Acts 2 and 1 when the Holy Spirit came into the upper room? It says when the day of Pentecost was fully come. How many of you understand that God has always worked inside his time frame? And I've said fooey on that many times. Man, I want him to do things when I need them. We are so used to running down to the convenience store. We, in my part of the country, they call them Stop and Rob. You need to, even in the plan of salvation, it had to be structured on God's time clock. How many of you understand that the publishing company in your Bible between Malachi and Matthew that there is really more of a statement than them just putting, grandma and grandpa's birth and when the kids were born and everybody, when they passed? How many of you know what I'm talking about? Maybe you got one of those right there in the center of the Bible. I want you to know that the Lord didn't look down through time. Although he is omniscient and omnipresent and he's all-knowing, he didn't break that up so that the publisher could put that in there. There is 400 years of silence. No man, no woman of God, no voice from heaven that spoke during that time. It was a very critical time from the end of the old covenant to the beginning of the wording of the new. And yet, in the book of Matthew, I'll tell you, one of the first things we recognize is that Jesus did come. And then Paul shines a light on our salvation in Galatians 4:4. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent his son. Not a day before, not a day late. It has always been according to his perfect timing. He does nothing prematurely. He displayed this attribute in Pentecost. We saw it. We all get little doodities running up down our spine. I have used it. Pat has done. How many preachers in this building? Hold up your hand. Ever been able to stand in a pulpit and preach this gospel? How many times have we gone to Isaiah 28 verses 8, or rather 11 and 12? And I'll read it to you because I want to prove a point to you. For with stammering lips and another tongue would he speak to this people, to whom he said, "This is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing." I have quoted that, I have preached that, and waited for the results of the people to get so excited. But how many of you know that that's not where the verse quits? There's a full colon there that says, "Yet they would not hear." Why? It's not on God's timing. I'm not saying they were right or they were wrong. I'm telling you that on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost did set upon man, and in the wisdom of God, it was perfect timing. For we know that Jesus had already put a command on him, had he not? Told him, what, Luke 24:49, "Go tarry in Jerusalem till you're endued with power from on high." Why? Because he wanted them to win their known world for Jesus Christ. I've got to submit to you, church, that what they were unable to do, the task was beyond anything that they could imagine. They must have thought their Lord has lost his mind. But I want you to know that on the other side of Pentecost, when they walked out of the upper room, there was nothing that they lacked. There was nothing they needed anymore to win their world for Christ. And that same touch of God is upon your life. No reason that most of Angleton, Texas should not be serving our God tonight. I want you to look how the Holy Ghost came. I believe the manner of his arrival carries this importance to us. Verse 2 and 3. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. It filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it set upon each of them. I just got to tell you, the Holy Ghost didn't arrive by some humanistic form of church growth. How many of you understand that? There was no seminar. God sent this wonderful gift. It was a gift from our Father. It was Jesus' baptism to his people. I love this. How many of you remember when we sang it, "He's got the whole world in his hands"? Well, that's true. He's got the whole world in his hands, but he's got believers encircled around his heart. Amen. I want you to know that's who he gives this to. I can tell you this. The early church did not question it. Those old apostles didn't sit around and quibble about it and worry with it. Can I get rid of this? Yeah, I'm bound up. It won't button anyway. As if you didn't already know that. Those people across the street who were not part of the fellowship of believers in Christ were asking, "What meaneth this?" But that body of believers knew that God had handed them something fresh and new, and nobody around that room was sitting there quibbling, wondering whether it was meant for them or not. It saddens my heart to know that there are people in our congregations today that they love our worship. They love the way that we stand and pray, and maybe they have even been a benefactor of some of us laying hands on them and being delivered of some terminal disease, or maybe their family delivered out of a horrible bondage of some sort. And yet, when we get to the place that we want to turn the Holy Ghost loose, boy, when it comes to the gifts of the Spirit, oh, no, no, no. Shakamo Shai, pass me on by. That body of believers knew something powerful had happened to them, and it wasn't just speaking in tongues or eight other gifts. God had just given birth to the church. They felt an empowerment, an endowment for service. It was literally putting on of their spiritual tool belt, and now there is nothing with that kind of unity that spans all the way back to Genesis, the 5th chapter, at the Tower of Babel, when God looked upon humanity and said, the people are one. Now there is nothing left that they cannot do. That this is a more powerful type of unity of believers by the power of the Holy Ghost. And now they're going to win the world for Jesus Christ. And by the end of Acts of the Apostles, they had turned their world upside down for Jesus Christ. Can't tell you what it would feel like for me and Mona to get down the road. I'd sure put it in my newsletter if it was heard that Central Assembly of God in Angleton, Texas had turned their world upside down for Jesus. That Angleton, a mighty revival, hit this. Hey, it can happen, and by God's help, it will happen. But please, if you don't like this thing called the baptism of the Holy Spirit, find you a church that preaches something that you can stick your feet under that chair in front of you and make yourself a home. If I was going to be Baptist, I'd go down the road to be the best Baptist in town. If I was going to be Lutheran, I'd go make myself a part of the Lutheran church. And I love those churches. The only thing moving down there is the ivy growing out back. If I was going to be Episcopalian, I'd be a good Episcopalian, because anywhere you have four Episcopalians, you can find a fifth. Lord, I apologize. Don't bother calling the district office. They already know. They know. No, sir. The elders didn't question this. They received it with open arms. God had made good on a promise to send Jesus, and now he's made that provision for the Spirit to dwell in us 24/7. No more of Samson having to wait around for something cataclysmic to take place for the Spirit of God to come upon him. Now, that inner workings of the power of God, having the mind of God, I want you to know it dwells in us 24/7. Daily we can walk with him and talk with him, have his Spirit abide in us. It says right here, if not shouting by now, turn the page. I want you to see who the Holy Ghost came to. Verses 3 and 4, it came upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Aren't you glad that God is no respecter of persons? My Bible teaches that every waiting and believing heart, he will fill. And that manifestation of power was different in each of their lives. But with this baptism of the Spirit, he empowered them with all nine gifts of the Spirit named in 1 Corinthians, that 9th chapter. And the Holy Ghost was such a powerful manifestation that it attracted the unbeliever. I run through this quickly. I've told you before, but when Mona and I were dating, and they're in Channelview High School, and I was a senior, she was a freshman. Man, I tell you, I spotted her. Woo! She was down at the water fountain. I know you're going to think I went to school with country and western singers, but David Frizzell was my buddy in high school, not the singer. And I looked at David and I said, who is that pretty little girl in that micro mini skirt? And he said, oh, you play football with her brother, Mark Reed. I said, Mark's got a sister? He said, yeah, that's Mona. She's the freshman cheerleader. I said, whoa, I'm asking her out. And immediately David yelled to the top of his lung, down, hey, Mona, Gene's going to ask you out. Scared the bejeebers out of me. And I did. As soon as I got home, I tell you, I had a friend knew their phone number, and I called her. And man, I forget that first date. That's where we found out that I couldn't boot scoot and boogie. If you've ever seen the movie The Jerk with Steve Martin, I could play the lead role in that. I am envious of people that can bust a move, because I haven't got it. Mona has told me many times, look, you do better dancing in the spirit than you ever did trying to dance on the dance floor. What possessed me on the, oh, I remember why, the next night, I'm going to take her to my church. My dad had built that church in 1967, and Dad had left there to go pastor elsewhere, and I stayed behind to keep an eye on the sisters. And man, I tell you, I had to take Mona to that church because that church had seen the girl I had dated before Mona. Look, I look at this every day in the mirror. I know. I get it, okay? I know the cheer. U-G-L-Y, you ain't got no alibi, you ugly. Yeah, I got it. I know. Man, I was nearly 6 foot tall and skinny. I could stick out my tongue, turn sideways, and look like a zipper. Tread water in a garden hose. I think Coach used to put me on defense just to watch me get run over. My friend, man, we walked up. Brother B.L. Wiggins, I didn't know if you remembered Brother B.L. He went to Greensboro for a while there under Brother Granberry's pastorate. And Brother B.L. Wiggins was our pastor after Dad had left. And bought just a sweetheart of a pastor. And thank goodness Sister Wiggins wasn't preaching. Because, buddy, if she bust your hide. But she normally always got Sunday nights. And I just knew, Pastor, man, I waited long enough that the offering had already been taken. It's important when you're 18 years old. Man, I was broken the Ten Commandments. I walked in that church, and I remember reaching and getting the door. They need some WD-40 on it really bad. Because every eye in that house, every head seemed to turn and look back. About the time I looked at Mona and said, hey, where are you and your family go to church? Because surely everybody's Pentecostal. And she said, East Belt Baptist Church. I said, oh. This is the big one, Elizabeth. We walked in that church and sat on the back row. And I've heard people talk ugly about the back row. I've got a question for you. If you don't have a back row, where are you going to start? Isn't that deep? We went back there, and right in front of us, Dennis and Nelda Perkins. And
And man, how could I know? They were playing that ungodly contemporary worship, that song that like got my daddy run out of Channel View because he lived by Bill Gaither. And I just knew nobody was going to run, shout, get excited to because he lives. How could I know that Nelda Perkins, who was standing in front of us, that because he lives, punched her button, and that's what they were singing at the invitation the night she got saved. And her little old left hand started giving it this. I already told you how skinny I was in the day, and I was trying to cover her up, and I wasn't doing a very good job of it. Mona kept looking around me. I said, don't ask any questions. She had already made a statement about our pastor and said he must be about the most rudest pastor that she had ever heard of. I said, you've never met the man. How can you call him rude? She said, look at all these people with their hands raised, and he won't answer none of their questions. I knew this is going to be a short date. This is not going to be good. And sure enough, Nelda's right hand got lonely, and it joined her left hand. And in just a moment, she broke out right there in those pews like a bucking horse coming out of chute number 9. Woo! Man, she's hopping and jumping, and her husband, old Dennis, he just moved over a little bit to let her have a little room. And Mona looked at me like old Wendy Bagwell and the his singing group when they tried to hand him a snake in Tennessee in that old church. And, you know, where is the door, or where do you want one? I looked at her. I said, I'm so sorry. I said, man, I was a backslidden preacher's kid singing in all them old clubs. And man, the last thing I needed is for her to be influenced up with Pentecost, and I sure didn't want her to get it. That thing's infectious. Do you know that? If you stay around it very long, it's like an old slippery creek bank. You're going to slip in sometime. I remember coming in one night, Pastor, had that old welding cap on, working as a pipe fitter out of 211, and I union, and I walk in, and I pull my cap off, and I'm looking for my girlfriend. The youth sat in one area, and Mona's not there. They had a communion table in that church sitting right at the front, and right underneath where it says, this do in remembrance of me, I looked. I said, oh, no, it's Mona in that micro mini skirt. She's laid out on the floor, and them women's ministries, the director and all of her cohorts in crime are down there with them courtesy cloths, afraid Mona's going to make the wrong move. They've been throwing them cloths on her. Look like they're making a quilt at the front of the church. I looked down that. I know. I cried. I said, no, no, no. I got her to the car. She just praying in the spirit. She says, oh, did you see that? What happened, man? I said, oh, God, I don't know. Get in the car. Whatever you do. That 66 Chevrolet Super Sport, man, I let the hammer down on that thing trying to get out of that driveway of that church. And all the way home, I'm saying, don't you tell your mama nothing. I love my mother-in-law, but boy, she's Baptist. What was it? The Amishman that had the old cow that kept kicking back on him and said, you keep that up. Thou knowest I'm an Amish and I cannot harm thee, but I will sell thee to a Baptist deacon and he'll beat the living tar out of thee. I was scared to death to go home and take her home. And I said, please tell me. You won't say nothing. I won't say anything to mom and dad. Can I tell you, it wasn't 10 days later. I want to say 2 weeks, but it was 10 days later that her mom pulled her aside and said, when you were at Jean's church the other night,
Did something spectacular happen to you? Mona's eyes got big as saucers. She said, Mona, did you get filled with the Holy Ghost and speak in other tongues? And Mona began to weep. She said, it's okay, baby. She said, Mama, how did you know? She said, there is such a change in your life. It is all over you. There is a glow about your life. There's an illumination. Church, I'm telling you, some of us have forgotten to stay plugged in and stay under the spout where the glory comes out. You've lost that illumination. That bothers this evangelist. That radiant glow about your life that spoke to others that nobody, you didn't have to walk the streets speaking in tongues. You didn't have to walk in the grocery store, the public, operating in the gifts of the Spirit. Your life filled with the Holy Spirit is a radiant glow about you. It's an illumination of the faith of God that He's placed down in your spirit. She's never been the same. Never been the same. Devil's tried to kill her. Poured the doctrines of the church into our girls and now into our grandkids. Now, am I doing okay? Forgive me, I hate boring preaching. So if I get bored and lean over and talk to somebody, I'll see it. And I'm glad Billy's not sitting by anybody. Now, what was the sign that they had been filled? Well, most of you know that the physical evidence was that they spoke in other tongues. I don't know why people struggle with this. You know, the Lord gave us some wonderful direction. How many of you know it was the power of God being manifested through men and women? And how many of you understand that the Holy Ghost doesn't have a tongue, so He has to use yours? What was it? I've never preached that you had to speak in tongues to get to heaven, but I wouldn't go to Walmart without it. What was it, two cowboys? Brother Brankle told this years ago, said them two cowboys walked in the Pentecostal church and heard somebody speaking in tongues, and one looked at the other and said, I believe that speaking in tongues is of the devil, don't you? He said, well, Lord, no. If it was, me and you both would have it. I love speaking in tongues. I know I didn't ruin a good message, but I was going to tell it tonight about praying in the Holy Ghost in that room, and the Spirit of God just helping me rest and taking that pain out of my body. 1969, I'm 16 years old. Mom wakes me up, says, hey, get in the car. We got to take Dad to work. We get to his Shell Refinery over on 225, get back on the road, go across the Lynchburg Ferry, and head back to Channelview. They had put four-way stop signs. We were glad to get curbs and stop signs. That's early, boy. We had Interstate 10 had not been there but about 10 years when all of this happened, and they finally got up there on Bio Drive and those different roads up there. We took one of those exits and came up to the stop sign, and Mom stopped at a Oldsmobile, looked both ways. As she proceeded through the intersection, a guy I went to school with, old Joey Rogers, he come flying through the intersection. Y'all remember back before motorcycles, they hadn't grown up yet. They were motor scooter. And I forget the brand. That's not important tonight, but I remember it just wasn't a full-grown motorcycler. It may have killed him, but he went over the hood of that car, and his head hit that curb, and he immediately looked like he was going into his death throes. I knew I was in no shape to stay and help him. I wasn't a paramedic, and I wasn't right with God at the time. Go figure. But I looked at my mama. She bailed out of that car, and she ran to him, and I hollered at her. I said, Mom, His name is Joey, Joey Rogers. And I took off down a hill to, there's no 911, certainly no cell phones in those days. And I ran down there. And while I'm running down the hill, I hear Mom. She's calling out his name, Joey. Joey, son, hold on, Joey. We're getting you help. And she starts praying over him. Jesus touched Joey. I heard her praying the English. And, boy, I heard her get a little stammering lips. And I thought, oh, goodness, not out here in public, surely. Man. And my mom was about to get serious with God, and she's praying in English and in a little stammering, and all of a sudden, I sensed my mama. I could feel, right now, the little hair standing up on the back of my neck, knowing how my mama touched God, and she began to pray in the Spirit. Man, I run up that driveway, and I got to the door to ask them to call. In fact, I really took my time getting back up there. I was afraid if I got there too early, Mom would ask me to come over and lay my hands on him, and I didn't want her spirit coming through him into me. Buddy, woo! I'd have got a refilling right there, kneeling beside Joey. This boy is bleeding from every orifice in his head. I just know it's over for him. I hear the siren. Sure enough, by the time I get there, man, they're lifting that boy up, putting him on a gurney, taking him to the trauma center down at Herman Hospital. And there's no lifeline in those days. And, man, well, I remember we jumped in the car and ran back and got Dad, goes home and cleans up a little bit. We get in the car, and Mom stayed home. She's so upset over the scene of this thing and what happened. When we walked into Herman Hospital, they're all his family are waiting there. I knew his family. I introduced myself to him. Oh, son, we remember you. We've seen you before. And they begin to talk to Dad. They knew my dad. And their restaurant was on Market Street there in Channelview. And Dad pastored not far from there. And so they realized. And Dad began to apologize. And Mom just sent her, just benevolence in her spirit, just grieving over hurting their boy. And they said, Brother Summers, the Harris County deputy has already filled us in. Our boy ran that stop sign and hurt himself. This is not your wife's fault. We already know that. And Dad said, with that, can we just pull together and go to praying? And we went to praying and believing God. And I don't know where he came from, but it was almost like he was looking over our shoulder. The surgeon just seemed to appear. I see him coming in the door with that little cap on. He's ready to do surgery. And he begins to explain to us. He said, we know the boy's going to have brain damage. And they begin to weep. And he said, I can't help that. But right now there is fluid rushing in on his brain, and his brain began to swell at the same time. With the fluid coming in and his brain swelling, he said, I've got to try my best to save this boy's life. I believe if I get back in there and put a shunt in his neck that we're going to drain that fluid and save your boy's life. We'll talk later with the neurologist about how much brain damage he's going to have. Just y'all stay in the spirit of prayer. He was kind, and he walked on out. But they just began to grieve immediately. They went to their chairs so let down. They sat down. My dad reached up and got me by the shirt and drugged me out the door. That had happened before. I thought, I haven't done anything. He pulled me out the hallway, and the chapel couldn't have been two doors down. I thought, well, if I got to go, chapel's a good place to have to meet my maker. And boy, Dad pulled me in there. He said, talk to me. I said, what, Dad? He said, tell me what happened this morning. I said, well, I really didn't want to get out of bed. We took you to where? He said, no. I'm not worried about the trip. Tell me how your mama responded at the scene of the accident. I stood up right and looked at my dad right in the face. I said, let me tell you, my mama touched God. I said, when I was running down that hill, and I said, Dad, I don't have any other way to describe this to you, but that I heard Mama praying in English, and then when she went in the Spirit, Dad, I felt it. She switched gears. That's the only description as a 16-year-old that I had at that moment. And I said, Dad, the little hair stood up on the back of my neck because I felt my mama touch God. Boy, he said, I knew it. I knew it. Let's go. I said, what'd I say? What'd I say? What did I say? Then he said, well, come on. We headed out. I'm following him like a little pup. We walked in that room. Hey, Roger's family got good news for you. I thought, good news? I didn't tell him nothing, but Mom was praying in the Holy Ghost. What are you talking about? He said, woo! He said, talk to my boy here. And my wife, when she prayed for your boy, she walked into the holies of holies. She walked into the throne room of God on your boy's behalf, praying in the Holy Ghost, and your boy is going to be all right. There's not going to be any brain damage. I said, oh, my Lord. Robert Tilton is nowhere around. Just save it, Mona. Are you kidding me? I thought, oh, my Lord. I can't believe that just came out of my daddy's mouth. I'm having my little fit over here in the flesh. And about that time, I look up, and here comes that old chief of surgeons of Herman Hospital. And he is walking in there. He has got four of those x-rays under his arm. And he walks. I never noticed it, never seen it, until he walked to it. One of those machines, the lights up, and he started slapping those x-rays in there. And he said, here is what was your boy's brain look like. This is the pressure that was being applied to him. This is where the fluid was pouring in. This is where we measured his brain. Right there, the little pin mark that you see around it is really inside, is where it should have been. We knew that there had to be damage. But look right here. Right here is where the brain quit swelling. And right here is where the fluid quit pouring in around his skull. And this right here is a picture of a perfect 17-year-old boy. We're going to keep him tonight and release him in the morning. If you don't believe in praying in the Holy Ghost, you came way too late. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. For the Spirit himself maketh intercession with groanings that cannot be uttered. Her mama, on the way to the hospital, I won't go through the whole story, but Mona had a seizure in the middle of the night, 1991. In July, her mama in May had gone to camp and got filled with the Holy Ghost. I remember when she came to my office begging me, Daddy, please pray for me. I need the Holy Ghost. My sister April is younger than me, and she's already got filled with the Holy Ghost in children's church. That's why I was telling our youth pastor today how sincere, how much our kids need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Our children's ministries directors, please do whatever you can to cause our kids to fall in love with the Spirit. Amen. Can I tell you, going down to see King Parkway, I had nothing. I'm not going to tell you what my Sunday looked like, but I had nothing to give. We come up over the railroad tracks, and I remember looking. They were building the new Dairy Queen on the corner of Highway 90 and CE King Parkway. When I got there, started to take a right, I had been trying to find every bit of music in my truck, trying to
find a lead-in to pray for my wife. I heard them. In fact, April heard them in the ambulance, rather. We're losing her. We're losing her. Get the paddles ready. They're going over right in front of that Dairy Queen when they took a right on Highway 90, and I'm right behind them in that big black dually of mine. I put that cow catcher on the front of that black dually on that sign on the back of that ambulance that says, stay back 500 feet. I helped push them to St. Luke's Hospital. When we got by that Dairy Queen there, I hear the most beautiful language, prayer language, Pastor. There ain't nothing like hearing your kids pray in the Spirit. I've witnessed it. I want every one of my grandkids full of the Holy Ghost. Nothing more. All of a sudden, our eyes meet. And Janelle looks at me and says, oh, I'm sorry, Daddy. You're the man of God. You're the one that needs to be praying. I said, right now, baby, Daddy has nothing to give. Please let the baby cry. With that, she threw up both hands in the cab of that truck, and she began to pray in the Holy Ghost. Right there in front of the Dairy Queen. Take off to Houston. Have you ever tried to park an old farm truck, a dually? Is that right, sister? Yeah. And you know, the signs at St. Luke's Hospital where the ambulance park doesn't say no parking. It says don't even think of parking here. And that's where I nosed that thing. I run in that there, and they had beat us there, but just a minute or two, and those nurses, I had just been there and left there at the midnight hour, trying to keep from telling y'all this, but Sister Iona Price had passed away. I'd been there just a few hours before. Those nurses, charge nurse, recognized that, Reverend, who are you looking for? I said, I'm looking for Mona Summers. She gave me the number over the room down there. I took off running down through there with Janelle, her mama, in tow. And I'm getting down there quick as I can, and here comes paramedic and EMT and somebody that was helping them, one of their helpers. And they're guff-hawing and making jokes, and it upset me. Hey! Oh, hey, Mr. Summers. You looking for Miss Summers? No. I'm looking for Sister McGillicuddy. Goobers. Oh, well, she's down there. Her and your daughter are talking to the neurologist. I said, she's awake? She's conscious? Hey, preacher, craziest thing happened. We're coming down C. King Parkway, and we cross over the railroad tracks there, and we started losing her. Scared your little 11-year-old. We scared her to death. I'm sorry about that, but we had to warm up the paddles to get ready to bring her back to life. And well, you know where they're building that brand new Dairy Queen on the corner of Highway 90? Yeah, he said. She sat up off of that gurney and said, "Hey, what's going on?" Hasn't had a seizure since. We know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself maketh intercession. I got to tell you, though. I got to tell you why I'm preaching this message. Because I'm a changed man. It's not all about just speaking in tongues or the nine gifts of the Spirit anymore. No. I'm catching myself. I'm finding myself standing in churches, in your church and others like you now, and during worship time, not caring whether they're singing, bringing in the sheaves or alternate. It just doesn't matter to me anymore, because I'm having my own opportunity right there at that moment. I'm telling Jesus how much I love Him. It amazes me how, Liz, when we were kids and we sang, you know,
oh, how I love Jesus. And now as an adult, I feel like for years I've strayed away from the simplicity of the moment of telling him, and I'm back now at the place where I'm looking at him and saying, after the things that I've gone through, there's nothing for me to do anymore but say, Jesus, I love you.
Yeah.
And now, when you do that with the power of the Holy Spirit running through your veins, search my congregation. I'm humorous, but this is not a humorous moment. I recognize it, and there are people in this room that are my elders that know what I'm talking about. We're watching day in and day out of these commercials that come on that deal with men and women having greater intimacy. Somebody is spending billions of dollars to try to help people regain something in their health, to come back, to have that moment of intimate relationship again. And I'm telling you that in the spiritual realm, our Lord has given us something by the power of the Holy Ghost, that I can have the most intimate relationship with my Lord and Savior. To know Him is to love Him, and to love Him is to know Him. Stand with me. Stand with me. Let me get to this. Yeah. Troy, where's Troy? Yeah, come, Troy. I may not quit, but you'll give them some hope. Somebody said that you can't have your cake and eat it too, but you can in Pentecost. And I'll tell you, power of the Holy Spirit is just the icing on the cake. Don Brankle, dear evangelist friend of ours, pastoring his first church at 15 years of age. Man walked in wanting to have a conversation with him at lunchtime. The man just happened to own the car dealership in their hometown. Don, riding a paint mare to church there in home, every service, rain or shine, thought for a moment, that man is coming to give me a car. I know that's what it is. You're going to give me a car. And the man, sure enough, sat down in his office on a Monday around lunchtime and said, Don, called him Donnie. I can't imagine calling Don Brankle Donnie. But he's only 15. He said, Donnie, you're making a great pastor. And he said, while that man was talking, I was just picking out the color, where I wanted the chrome at, you know, in those days. He said, you love elders and you love the youth alike. You go to the hospital, and I know you had to ride that mare everywhere you go to do those hospital visits. He said in the back of his mind, he was saying, I knew it. I knew it. That man is fixing to give me an automobile. And he said, but Donnie, I have one problem with you. And he said, I saw that car fly right out the window. What? And he said, well, as good a pastor as you are, and you have caused this church to grow, but you've got one big problem, son. You need to leave that preaching on the Holy Ghost alone. You just need to walk away from that, Donnie, and leave that alone, and you're going to be a good pastor. You're just going to take care of our church, and we're going to grow. Good things are going to happen. And he said, I don't know where at 15 or 16 years old I mustered the ability to speak to that man on an authoritative level. He said, I put both fists on my desk and raised myself erect and stood there behind that desk and looked at him and said, sir, there's a lot of things in life that I may have missed, but I got to tell you something. I didn't have anything till I got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. Then Don Brankle went on to write the message, Not for Sale. I've heard him preach it many times, Not for Sale. Ahab, standing at that man's door, says, Naboth, looked at your vineyard, pal. In the King James Version, Pat, it says it was hard against the palace. Ahab must have thought, why haven't kings before me ever procured that piece of ground? It was the most beautiful piece of property in that side of Israel. And Ahab, the most wicked king the Bible says had ever lived or ever would live. None before him more wicked, none after him. And he stands there telling Naboth, I want this, and I'll give you another piece of property. I got a peach orchard right down the road that I'll be glad. It's worth a lot more than yours. And Naboth pulled a Don Brankle on him. He said, I cannot give to thee what has been given to me. My fathers. I'm not willing to give this up. It's the message of Pentecost. If all you can see is speaking in tongues and the gifts of the Spirit, you have missed the Holy Ghost a million miles. It's so much more than that. Let me tell you where I'm at. I'm crossing this country, and I thank Mona and I thank my family for walking with me through this walk of sacrifice that I have drugged my family through. But I'm telling you, we're not giving up telling people about the power of God unto salvation and the baptism of the Holy Ghost. What I'm sincerely, my heart grieves over is people in our churches today that got filled with the Holy Spirit, Pastor, 20, 30 years ago, decades ago, and they haven't talked in tongues since. Can I help you? You don't have it. Well, you can't judge me. Sure. I know my buddies told me when you get on the field, I would never tell Jonathan this, that when he gets on the field, that it's his responsibility to get all the new converts filled with the Holy Ghost. When they told me that, I said, then what's the church doing the other 51 weeks out of the year? If that's my responsibility. My responsibility is to be an alarm clock to the church. I'm supposed to come in and be such an alarm clock to you that when new converts walk in the door of this church, there is such a radiance about your life and such an illumination about you that they want every gift that they see in your life. Father, we bind together with cords that cannot be broken. I'm praying over your congregation right now, Jesus. Walk through this place right now. And if there are people here tonight that the enemy has done his best to beat their brains out and steal the sweetness out of their life, steal the tongues, steal the gifts of the Spirit, I pray, Father, right now that they get hungry, because there's going to come a day when praying in the Spirit is going to be as important to them as it was to Mona and I, to me and my family, my home. I'm praying, Jesus, right now. Right now, would you walk through this room and by God's help and authority, would you touch some people and make them hungry for this wonderful gift again? Mona, come join me, baby. Come stand with me. You're here, and tonight you say, you know what, Brother Gene, you're right. I'm not mad at God. I hadn't walked out on God. Brother Gene, honestly, I love him with all my heart. But I've lost that intimate relationship that I used to have with the Master. I need a glorious refilling and infilling of the Spirit of God. I want you to step out. Come on. I want to pray with you right now. Yeah. Come, baby. Stand right here.